Station, this is Houston. Are you ready for the event?
And Houston Station, we're ready for the event.
WTTV, this is Mission Control Houston. Please call station for a voice check.
Station, this is Frank Nickens. How do you hear me?
Hello, Frank. This is Station. We hear you loud and clear. How me?
All right. Great to see you again, Scott.
Great to see you again,
We'll get you going here. We'll try to make this as brief as possible. First, what was the launch like? The feeling inside, the power? Do you get queasy?
Well, the launch was an amazing event. Obviously, we trained hard for a couple of years to be ready for all of the contingencies that could happen. But it was a perfectly normal event, a nominal event the whole way. I remember sitting there and feeling very comfortable, strapped into my seat, and all of a sudden you feel a little bit of rumble as the center core starts to ignite it and started to burn. And then I knew it was just going to be a few more seconds and we'd be off to the races. Then you could feel the boosters light up, and then the holdback towers came back and let us go, and you could feel a little bit of motion, and it felt like just a gentle push at first, and then you started feeling a little bit of the roll commands coming in, and you knew the vehicle was flying properly, and once we got through max dynamic pressure, we really started accelerating up to almost about 4 G's, and that's when it really got exciting. As the second stage burned out, we got thrown forward in the straps just a little bit, and then the third stage kicked in, and we got thrown back into the seat a little bit, and I looked at the commander, and he looked at me, and we had both had smiles from ear to ear. The machine was just working great, so it was actually a great ride, a great 10-minute ride up to low Earth orbit.
Well, a lot of people might want to know, how in the world do you connect with your family, and how did that work for the holidays?
Well, as a military person, this is my fifth deployment, and I've been gone on holidays for a lot of those. So it's not the first time being gone. My family has a routine, and they get into it, and they have fun. But this time, we had some good connectivity. The folks that put this community together and built this amazing machine have some good connectivity. We have phone call capability. We have video conference capability, and we have email. And we had a lot of communications over the holidays. I was able to spend Christmas Eve with my family, and then a little bit on Christmas Day, and the same for New Year's Eve and New Year's Day. It was absolutely a fabulous couple of days spent with family as best we could. And it's definitely a life memory, very unique to be able to spend Christmas with a loved one on Space Station and being on Space Station with your loved ones back on Earth.
Together, was it video conferencing? Were you opening gifts? Were you watching them open gifts? Exactly how did it look?
It was pretty much the dog and pony show with the kids making fun of me the whole time. I was on station watching them and talking to them. We didn't time it out so that they would be opening gifts, and they had just gotten back from a long trip for the launch as well. So there was a very subdued, quiet time at home. I have two Dalmatians, and they were barking and playing in the background. My 15-year-old was playing with them, and my 15-year-old son and my 20-year-old son. We're kind of bickering back and forth a little bit. And my daughter, who lives in New York City, my wife actually got creative and held FaceTimed her telephone to telephone and then held her phone up to the video. So we actually had the whole family together, and we spent most of the time just talking and reliving some of the stories that that we had experienced over in Russia for the launch.
Yeah, sounds like a treat for you. Well, I see you've got your Purdue pennant up over there, and you're a Purdue graduate, 23rd Boiler selected for space travel. Talk a little bit about how you feel Purdue got you where you are.
Well, I've always said that deciding to go to Purdue University was one of the best decisions I've ever made in my life. you know, they've got such a great program. They really get into the details of theoretical. When you come out of Purdue University in the engineering field and the other fields, as far as I can tell, you really have a good basic understanding on what your discipline is all about. And more so, you're comfortable getting your hands dirty and actually getting into the design work and making things happen. That's really, I think, the value that Purdue brings to the table. They're very good at doing that and molding students into professionals. And so doing that, really helped me get my first engineering job. It helped me through a Navy flying career and being a test pilot with a good engineering background. And obviously, it's helping me a lot here with all of the technical things going on. Not to mention the huge network of people. We have a lot of boilers at NASA. We had a lot of Purdue folks at the engineering places that I've had the privilege to work with as well.
Talk a little bit about how space travel, I mean, you're up there, looks like you've got zero gravity working right now. How does that affect your body? How does that change some of the things that we do daily that you have to do differently in orbit?
Sure. Well, the obvious things are, you can't walk. You have to just kind of float. So you have to control your flight path or your velocity vector, and you do that by kind of, you know, doing a little momentum theory and just kind of using your hands to get around. That's kind of the obvious things. But the things that that you don't think about is, well, okay, how do I get this piece of food into my mouth and not have it make a mess all over the place? Or when you have to move from one place to another and take something out of a bag, you have to think about, okay, I have to put the bag in a certain place. The bag has to be secure. Now I have to secure myself so that I don't move. When I go to open the zipper, I don't want to move my body. I want to move the zipper. And little things like that. And it becomes a little bit more natural the more you get adapted and until you start actually thinking like that. And at first, you can do it fairly easy, but you have to think about it and you have to force yourself to think about it. And when you forget, it's very obvious. But after a couple of weeks or a few weeks, the adaptation kicks in and you start thinking about it naturally, just like you would on Earth.
So obviously you love your family, so that's a given. But what else do you miss about having your feet planted firmly on planet Earth?
I miss riding my Harley Davidson. I put it away early so I wouldn't risk getting injured prior to the flight and throughout training. So it's been about 8 months or so since I've had it out, and I'm looking forward to getting back in next summer and getting a good ride out.
All right. Well, we can thank the space program for so many inventions: baby formula, camera phones, all kinds of gadgetry, insulation in our homes. Talk about your mission and how you think it could change life on Earth or beyond.
Mission, we have any given time between 200 and 260 experiments going on up here. There's lots of things going on. We're looking at germination of seeds with the Apex program. We've been active on that, and it's pretty cool to see how the seeds germinate and how the root structures grow in zero gravity. Another aspect of some things that we will be doing is controlling a robot from low Earth orbit and simulating exploring another planet such as Mars or some other entity, and being able to do that from the moon or from the station in low Earth in orbit around that planet would be critical to our human and exploration from away from Earth.
So you talked about the next frontier, I guess you could say, to steal some terminology from Star Trek there. But are you interested in this 9-month trip to Mars and the new adventure in terms of that mission that we're preparing for? I mean, does that at all tickle your fancy?
It does. I'm ready to go.
All right. Well, okay, so we talk about Mars and the idea of colonization, and we're talking about, you know, will seeds grow and how do they grow and all of that. What else could we see in terms of the future of space travel and life in space? What do you think?
really nice to get the commercial vehicles up and running, and those vehicles are making leaps forward in technology and how they operate and how we transport folks back and forth from space. Right now we're focused on low Earth orbit, but our Orion program and our heavy lift program is gearing up for a long duration, and a lot of the technology that we're working on now and with the new vehicles as well as up here on ISS will be critical in getting us to longer destinations or further destinations, such as the moon, orbits around the moon, Lagrangian points, and then off to Mars. I'm really looking forward to watching that process unfold.
Astronaut Scott Tingle from the International Space Station, Purdue grad, always a pleasure. Thank you so much.
It's great talking to you again. Have a great day.
Station, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the WTV portion of the event. Please stand by for a voice check from WFXT-TV.
Without Station, this is WFXT in Boston. Can you hear me?
Risky to keep them in the cold.
Thankful to you.
Hello, Boston. This is the International Space Station. Got you loud and clear. How me?
The fire will be out. Reroute the gas. Fix the...
All right, we're about 2 minutes out. You're talking with Gene.
So for the past couple of days, they've been working around the clock trying to get that gas main fixed. The MBTA has provided some heated buses so that they can get some relief from the cold weather. The Boston Fire Department also has been on hand, again, assisting if there are any problems. And they also have been providing some heated tents for their crews as well here. Live in Roslindale, I'm Joy DeMandin, Boston 25 News.
And all eyes on the commuter rail.
Can I get one more mic check, please?
Following the holiday. Boston 25 news reporter Catherine Parada is live at South Station. And Catherine, the message this morning is to expect delays with all of these.
I do not hear you.
And the MBTA certainly warning people about that well ahead of time. Now, in terms of what I'm seeing so far this morning, I've been checking the alerts. I'm seeing anything from cancellations for some trains on some of the lines, part of the Fitchburg line. They're busing people.
Great, you're coming up.
Modest delays, about 5 to 15 minutes. But again, the MBTA telling people, do not expect your trains to be on time today. And in fact, they were warning people as of yesterday to expect 20-minute delays across the board, and that was for both trains and buses. And the reason for that, they say, is the cold weather. They say that causes a lot of maintenance issues. The cold can cause issues with the train's air system, which controls brakes, doors, and other functions. Last week was when this extreme cold started, and at that time, we told you about some switch failures. Well, today, maintenance crews will be stationed at certain spots to try and keep the trains running. They'll also be swapping trains out at different ends to help safeguard against breakdowns, but that can slow service 5 to 15 minutes. Trains were also stored in tunnels overnight, and the heaters for track switches have been tested and will continue to be tested throughout the morning commute. Now, I have been speaking with some commuters this morning, and they tell me that really the worst that they've experienced so far today has just been having to leave their warm car and get out there and wait on the platform for these trains. But they say the trains have generally been warm, and they haven't had too much of a severe problem so far with the commute. But again, we're continuing to monitor that situation. Live here at South Station, Catherine Parada, Boston 25 News.
Now 8:36 this morning, and it's going to be an exciting 2018 for one Massachusetts native in particular. He'll be spending the first part of the year in space. Randolph native Scott Tingle already on board the International Space Station. He's joining us live now from space to update us on how things are going. And Station, this is Gene Levanchy in Boston. How do you hear me?
Gene, I got you loud and clear. How me?
Hey, you're loud and clear as well, Scott. Very exciting to talk with you this morning. First, I'm sure you know about the Arctic blast we've been dealing with here in Boston. Is it warmer in space than it is here right now?
Actually, it's really, really cold out there, but fortunately, we have a really good life support system, and it keeps the temperature somewhere between right around 73 to 78 degrees around the clock, so it's very comfortable.
Give us an idea of what your daily routine is like in space now.
It's fairly busy. We have a lot of things going on up here. We get up around 6 o'clock, and we have breakfast and review all the things that we need to review to have a productive day. And then we get busy, and we'll work on anything from one of 200 experiments. We'll do some maintenance. We'll monitor our water and make sure everything is a good fit for consumption. We'll get exercise. We have to lift weights to inhibit some of the or slow down some of the bone loss that we see up here. And then we do some cardio to keep our bodies in good shape. We have a little bit of a break. We eat space food. And then we do it again in the afternoon. And then once we get done, we kind of recap with a meeting and get ready for the next day. We generally sleep between 6 and 8 hours.
Now, this is your first flight. Obviously, you've had extensive training, but is it what you thought it would be like? Has it met your expectations being in space?
It's so much better. You know, you work very hard in training, and you have to focus on a lot of details, technical details, personal details, operational details, and you really get lost in those to just try to keep your performance as high as possible so that you can be as ready as possible. But once that's all behind you and you get here, it's a breath of fresh air. You get some really good friends up here. You've got a great, huge, productive professional team on the ground to help you and to guide you through the things that we're working on. And you get to float, and you get to do a bunch of different things that you are very unique to do as a human being.
And last question, Scott, are you able to watch the Patriots from the space station?
They had them on, but I think I was tied up in a video conference with my family at the time. But I am looking forward to watching some more sports, especially New England sports, when I can get the time.
All right. Well, Scott, thank you very much for your time. I know everybody in Randolph is extremely proud of you and what you're doing, and we look forward to following your accomplishments in space as the mission continues.
So much. Have a great day.
Station, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the event.
Thank you, all participants from WTTV and WFXT station. We are now resuming operational audio communications.